This week on Phone a Friend. Pull out your oldest, pilliest cardigans and step out for the Met Gala. I mean, Met Gala. Tom Brady was roasted to a crisp, but did it go too far? An A-list celebrity stalks her haters. And I celebrate Mother's Day by returning my mom's phone call.
I must say, occasionally I do feel a little embarrassed some of the topics that you choose. That's the absolute truth.
My Mother's Day gift to me is escaping from my children with you for an hour, phonies. So let's do this, mothers and friends.
Girl, let's phone a friend with Jessi.
Crookshank.
Hello, hello, hello. Welcome to a fun little Mother's Day edition of Phone a Friend. I'm Jessi Crookshank, mother of three. And today I'll be phoning my own mother. And my Mother's Day gift to her is forcing her to take a pop culture quiz live on this podcast. This is the woman who had never seen an episode of The Bachelor, if you recall, until this year. So hilarity is about to ensue. I am back from Toronto and Las Vegas. The launch of my Joe Fresh collaboration, by the way, in Toronto last week was a huge success. We sold out half the collection in less than 48 hours. So get your pieces now before they're gone. Hot tip, phonies. The Lovers and Friends Festival in Las Vegas was less of a success. Here to help me numb the pain is Jason, my producer. Hi, Jay.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm so sorry.
Thank you for offering your condolences. I needed to hear that. Thank you.
I'm here now. It's okay.
Mm-hmm. Do you know that like every one of my, you know, like mom friends at the kids' school who I talked about this for the last 5 months has also, it's been like there was a death in the family. They're like, hi, Jessi, I just wanted to say I'm so sorry. Heard about Lovers and Friends. Sorry.
Yeah.
Like everyone in my life knows how excited I was for this weekend. And I was excited for this episode, Jay, because I thought I would be a changed person talking to you right now, right? I thought I would be telling all of our phonies about the best day of my life. Because in January, on this very podcast, I announced that me and my five best friends from high school had gotten tickets to the Lovers and Friends Festival in Las Vegas because the lineup was an elder millennial's wet dream. And I just like to, you know, get moist once again by reading out a few of the artists. We're not even 3 minutes in, and Jason is straight gasping.
I just wasn't expecting that, but I want to hear the lineup again.
The Backstreet Boys, Usher, Janet Jackson, Nelly Furtado, Ludacris, Snoop Dogg, TLC, T-Pain, Neo, Lil Wayne, Lil Jon, Brandy and Monica, Ja Rule and Ashanti, Craig David, Khalees, Sean Paul, Jason Derulo, T.I., Genuine, Mace, M.I.A. 98 Degrees, Jason, was listed at the bottom of the poster.
Wow, I didn't know that. I did not even see them on the poster because it was that small,
I know, you would need a magnifying glass to see them. And for me, when 98 Degrees is last on the list of artists at a music festival, I need to move heaven and earth to be there. And that's what I did. And that's what my five best friends did. We booked flights, hotel, arranged childcare, planned coordinated outfits. I have never looked forward to something more in my entire life. Okay, so I had my whole launch event in Toronto. I flew straight to Las Vegas. My friends all arrived from Vancouver. We go out for a late dinner the night before the festival. And at like 10:15, we're kind of wrapping up dinner. We're going to go back to the hotel to get a good rest. Okay, because these elder millennial moms needed to be rested for the next day. So before we leave the restaurant, we're like, you know what? Let's pull up the festival schedule and just like make a plan. Because by the way, this festival was so stacked, all those artists and so many more in one day. You had Gwen Stefani playing at the same time as T-Pain, Usher on at the same time as Sean Paul. It was like Sophie's choice. Hard decisions needed to be made about the next day. So my friend Bryony pulls up the Lovers and Friends website on her phone, looks at it and says, that's weird. It says Lovers and Friends Festival canceled. Jay, this is less than 12 hours before the festival was supposed to start.
Wow.
They announced on their website that it was canceled due to wind. Now, I had been by the pool that day, and I did not feel even a gust. Jason, we're looking around the table thinking like, this is a joke. My first instinct was like, this can't be true. It was like, you know, when a celebrity dies unexpectedly and your first instinct when you see it on your phone is to not believe it. You're like, this is a hoax.
Yeah.
And then you're in shock and then you grieve and then you're angry. And then you like go to Twitter to see if other people are reacting. So that's what we did. And the first post we pull up on Twitter with the hashtag lovers and friends is literally somebody writing, just flew in from New Zealand for the Lovers and Friends Festival. Can't wait to see Khalees. I was like,
uh-oh.
Oof, if you will, you know? Who's going to tell that person her milkshake is not coming to the yard?
But that's why I wanted to ask you, was there wind? Was it windy? Was there like a tornado?
Jason, let me tell you. The following day, obviously, we had no plans. That was like the other thing is like not only had my six friends and thousands of people flown in from around the world, like we had spent money on hotel, on airfare. It was canceled so close to showtime. Not only could we not cancel those things, but we also had no other plans. Like, we had no reservations for anything. The only show with tickets available at that point in Las Vegas on Saturday night was Thunder Down Under, which I believe is like the podunk outback version of Magic Mike.
Which kind of like, want to see it.
Me too. Why do you think we were looking at the prices?
Right.
We were like, we are depressed and down for some off the strip Australian male strippers to rub up against us. But tickets to that were $140 each. Like, we had nothing to do with our days there. So to answer your question, we spent the next day by the pool. Jay, my hat stayed on. Okay? On my head. Umbrellas stayed erect. Like, unless the stages were made out of popsicle sticks, it was not a dangerous wind in my professional meteorological opinion. You know what I mean? And also, like, I hate to say this, but Taylor Swift shows go on in far more dangerous conditions.
Yeah.
That's the thing. I was like, unless there was a Wizard of Oz style tornado brewing, put Nelly and Ashanti on that stage stat, okay? Lil Jon can shout over a light breeze. It was like a windy day.
That's what I'm thinking too. Like, even if it was serious winds,
yes,
there had to be another option. Like the amount of time, effort, scheduling, people you've brought in.
Right.
The lineup. Like, it just seems like there could have been so many other solutions.
Obviously,
I don't know, but
no, that's what's shocking. There are major venues there. There are indoor stadiums.
Inside.
Move it inside. Pivot. Plus, by the way, rewind. Again, as a professional meteorologist, I was noting that flights were coming in and out all day long. On the day of the festival, like no flights were delayed due to wind.
Weird.
Our pool must have been in some kind of like helicopter path because all day helicopters were just casually floating over the pool. And we were like, there goes Janet Jackson. Like, by Mary J. Blige. Like, all of the artists just evacuating in helicopters from the premises.
Just to like rub it in your face even more.
Just to rub it in your face even more. And by the way, a few kind artists, lovely, you know, Usher, T-Pain, Snoop, all sort of like popped up and performed like apology shows, if you will. Like,
oh, that's cool.
Usher performed at a club. T-Pain performed at a pool party. We were there primarily, as you know, for the Backstreet Boys. And the only intel I could get on them is that they were spotted eating at a Wahlburgers. That tracks.
Yeah, on brand.
On brand. And by the way, let me tell you, like at some point, the desperation set in because I was the one who hooked up the tickets for my friends. I was the one who brought them all out there. So I felt like I was responsible for providing them with some kind of an experience without the festival. So I was like, what can I do? What like strings can I pull? So I just desperately, after a few glasses of rosé, start DMing every Backstreet Boy. Literally just like, hey guys, what are you up to? I have six horny moms looking to hang out.
Imagine. And
I tried. AJ read every single one of my fucking messages. AJ watched my reel that I posted. No response.
No response. No response. Wow.
No response. Yeah. And so there we had it.
I feel so bad for you that that happened. I would die.
I felt that way too. But then, like, obviously we had an amazing time.
Yeah, what do you do? You have to turn it around.
But you start to spiral and you start to think, I certainly started to think that this was, like, not about the wind. I started to feel like perhaps there was a bit of a Firefest situation at play because the list of artists alone, all playing on one day, seemed too good to be true from the jump. And the festival was really late putting out a schedule. Like, they only dropped the schedule a couple of days before the festival. So people thought maybe things were sort of chaotic and falling apart behind the scenes. And so when the festival organizers felt like they could use wind as an excuse to cancel, they did.
Yeah.
You know, like when I make plans and I don't really want to go when it comes time to do those plans and it rains, I'm like, oh, slippery roads, let's reschedule.
Yeah.
Same thing, but for 10,000 people. Silver lining. Was that my best? High school friends and I, who would never have planned an impromptu Vegas weekend together, obviously had like the best time ever because there was no pressure anymore.
Yeah.
We were like angry and sad and a little drunk. So all of us were like, fuck this. And we went out till 5 a.m. the night we found out the festival was canceled. We literally danced and clubbed the sadness away, Jason.
I love that. That you will have the best time. There's no expectations. There's no pressure. You're just like, right. You know, you can only go up from here. Let's have the best time.
We're literally stuck there. We can't get on the Mary J. Blige helicopter. We're at Caesar's Palace for 48 hours. So we made the most of it. And even if there was no lovers and friends, we still had friends, Jason, and so much love, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Mm. I will say, Evan also said, fuck this, at some point, texted me and made me fly home early on Sunday to help with the kids. He's like, you've been away for 6 days. There was no festival. You get your fucking ass home and work. That was a Kim Kardashian reference. I would never, my husband would never speak to me that way, but I did. So all in all, phonies, it's been a week.
It's been a week. Yeah.
Wait, footnote. Jason, did you have any idea how expensive things were in Las Vegas?
Like, I mean, I always kind of, I know Vegas is kind of like an expensive, but
Cheap Vegas. I thought there was like high-end Kardashian private jet, like Wynn Vegas. And then I thought there was like circus Vegas. Like, you can find a bargain in Vegas. Newsflash, there are no more bargains in Vegas. Jason, night two, we went to a cheap club. Okay, we went to a ladies get in free Steve Aoki DJ night. Okay. And I'll tell you why ladies get in free, because when my first lady friend went to order her drink, a double gin and tonic, well, gin, okay, Belvedere, whatever the fuck they had there, guess how much it cost?
Belvedere's vodka, but yes, could go on. And, okay.
I don't know anything. I kept calling him Dave Aoki. I don't know. Vegas, I'm not a Vegas girl. I'm just trying to keep up. Guess how much? The damn Belvedere gin.
$35, $35, $40.
A double gin and tonic at the shitty nightclub, Omnia, cost $57.
Did it come in like did it come in like a gimmicky cup?
Didn't even come in glass. Came in plastic, Jason. $57. She turned around, told us, and we were like, God damn it. Now we have to go, you know, befriend some like middle-aged rich guys with a booth. Can't pay $57 for a drink.
I love that she was like turned around. She was like, save yourselves. It's not too late.
Save yourselves. Do you see any rich guys who look like they have bottle service? Yeah. Go try to get behind their velvet rope, which we had to do. We had no other choice. All right. While I was refusing to pay $57 for a Belvedere and $140 to see Thunder Down Under, celebrities were paying $75,000 a ticket to attend the Met Gala. Did you know that, Jason?
No, I kind of, I guess, yeah, it makes sense. It's for, I don't know too much about the Met Gala, but like, I always just thought people were invited. If you were like a A-list celebrity, you're you're just on the list, but everyone has to buy a ticket because it's for the museum, right?
Yes, it's a fundraiser for the museum. It costs $75,000 per ticket.
Oh, wow.
So I don't think Kylie Jenner is paying for her own ticket. Like the designer who's invited her is paying for a table and paying for her ticket.
That makes more sense.
The cost per head. I had no idea. I just thought it was like a fun night for Sarah Jessica Parker to wear a lamp as a hat. So this year's theme was Sleeping Beauties, Reawakening Fashion. And ironically, some of the fashion did put me to sleep. Overall, I thought this was a pretty meh gala. You know what I mean? Like, nothing really seemed to happen at the after parties. No one posted drunk shots smoking in the bathroom like they've done in the past. Rihanna didn't show up an hour late in 20 square feet of fur. She didn't even show up, period. And like the fashion was good. There were some looks that I liked, but it wasn't particularly thrilling. Like I found myself missing Jared Leto in a cat mascot costume. You know what I mean?
Oh yeah. Yeah, I remember that.
I feel like ever since Katy Perry dressed as a cheeseburger to the Met, we have all been kind of paring it back ever since. I blame her. Like, that was the jumping of the Met Gala shark. It's hard to top cheeseburger. Even Kim Kardashian was like, you know, I've gone patterned. I've gone wet. I've gone wearing the dress of a dead woman. This time I'm just going to throw on a linty cardigan and call it a day. So the dress code was the Garden of Time. And I don't know about you, but I laughed listening to Kim try to make her Margiela metal corset gown and cardigan work with the theme. Listen to this.
This is like the wildest night of my life in a garden. And I just ran out and grabbed my boyfriend's sweater and threw it on and had to get to work. My hair is all messed up.
By that explanation, I think you could make anything work with the theme. Like, Jason, currently, I don't know what you're wearing. Feel free to describe your look. But right now I am wearing ripped oversized jeans and a stained white t-shirt. And my look was inspired by gardeners who work in the garden, toiling amongst the plants, growing florals from the earth through time and space.
Oh, that sounded erotic in a bit of a way.
Are you moist over there? A little bit? A little bit.
I was like, oh, where's this going?
Could you please describe your outfit and make it work with the garden theme?
I am wearing gym clothes that I had full intention of leaving the house to step in a gym, but I did not leave. So it's just
like a seed that never budded.
Exactly. Good
and it's
one.
Representing the time that has passed without going to the gym.
My body is a wilted flower petal.
Oh, God. So meaningful, so powerful. Yeah. What a gorgeous statement you're making today, Jason. Thank you. Plus, Kim Kardashian. The cardigan was controversial. I just felt like if your boyfriend's cardigan is that small and linty, I have concerns about your boyfriend. People were mainly upset about Kim's waistline, which I feel that we should address because there have been dozens of think pieces written at this point since Monday, criticizing her for squeezing her waist into that tiny corset. She was, you know, outwardly saying she could hardly breathe, she couldn't move, and that obviously promotes unhealthy beauty standards. I, however, would argue that Kim Kardashian exclusively promotes unhealthy beauty standards, corset or not. Like, at least she's doing it at an event that, by its very essence, is a celebration of unhealthy beauty standards. You know, for me, when she's at a costume institute gala, I don't find myself, like, looking at her and thinking, I too need my waist cinched like that. I'm literally thinking, like, oh, I could make that linty cardigan work. Like that to me, she was wearing a relatable ensemble compared to the others. You know, I'm more likely to compare myself to her when she's in her dirty gym clothes like you, Jason. That's when I look at the unrealistic beauty standards that she presents and compare her to me. Now that brings me to my best, worst, and sexiest dressed.
Best, worst, and sexiest dressed.
Before I crown best dress, I actually have so many honorable mentions and not enough time on this podcast to discuss them all. I would like to quickly put on my Anna Wintour sunglasses, 2 minutes on the clock, and go through a few of the looks I loved. Can I do that?
Yeah, I want to know what your like tops were.
Okay, you love my tops. 2 minutes on the clock. Here we go. I'm going to start with Mindy Kaling, who looked incredible in taupe Gaurav Gupta. Did you see this?
Yeah.
If you've seen my Joe Fresh collab, you know I love a taupe moment. Yeah. She said, quote, the cape was inspired by a blooming flower and the sculptural techniques evoked the passage of time. Didn't pick that up, but she looked great. Next, Sarah Jessica Parker. That hat, that hair, that sculptural embellished Richard Quinn dress. No one understands the assignment quite like SJP. Next, Nicole Kidman wore a couture 1950s Balenciaga made with 3,000 feathers. Birds perished in her garden, but she's never looked better. J-Lo. I'm also adding J-Lo to this list. Controversial. Do not at me. J-Lo emerged from a rough couple of months looking like a fucking goddess. Okay, granted, she's worn many versions of this Schiaparelli bodycon embellished gown, but this felt like a revenge dress. This was a heightened version of her looks in the past. Like, you didn't buy tickets to my tour, but that won't dim the J-Lo glow. Next, I'm throwing a man in here, a man I know well, Dan Levy. Looked like a gay Tom Selleck in his Loewe suit and mustache. I loved every inch of it. Did you see Dan J?
Yeah, yeah.
Doja Cat went from literal cat last year to a much more pared-down look. She wore a wet floor-length t-shirt by Vet Mom because she says cotton is the most used flower in the world. Smart and controversially, I loved it. Oh God, I only have 20 seconds to defend this. She had these chrome tears. It was like wet and clinging in a beautifully artistic way. I didn't think it was giving wet t-shirt contest in Cabo. It was giving fashion statement on an otherwise pretty dull carpet. Lastly, with my remaining 5 seconds, my final honorable mention goes to Cardi B, who had 7 men traveling with her to carry her dress. She did this huge over-the-top gown and I loved it. She did too. Here she is talking about it.
How does it feel to have 7 people helping you with your dress?
It makes me feel like, yeah, I'm that bitch, and you bitches could never.
Never.
Before y'all consider comparing yourself to me, bitch.
That concludes my 2 minutes of honorable mentions, bitch. Do you agree or disagree with those selections, Jason?
In general, blanket, I agree. Okay. I know I'm biased, but I would have put Kim in the top as well.
You liked the Linty cardigan? I did not.
I thought she looked cool.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. You know what she did look and she does do so well? She always causes a stir.
Yeah. What do you think about the Kylie pointy boob, like Barbie
Kylie
boob?
Kylie was so boring. Let's talk about sleeping beauties. We're just going to wear a plain cream gown. Like,
with pointy boobs.
Talk to Madonna. She's done it before, hon.
I liked it.
I think she looked beautiful, and I appreciate when women look beautiful on the Met Gala, but that's not what it's for. It's a costume institute gala. Like, come ready to eat. Is that what the kids are saying?
Yeah, I think something like that, yeah.
I tried to just drop that casually, but I couldn't. I've never said it out loud before, so I think that worked. Okay. Come ready to serve. Come ready to eat. You know what I mean? This brings me to my best dressed at the Met Gala. Drum roll, please. It goes to someone I had never heard of until Monday. My best dress is Tyla, a South African singer who wore sand. It was a Balmain gown made of literal sand that paid homage to sands through the hourglass, garden of time. I thought it was interesting. I thought it was artistic. I thought it was oddly beautiful. I thought she was beautiful and looked incredible. It required 4 men to carry her everywhere she went, which I fully support. Tyla, I would hate to sweep up after you, but congratulations on a 10 out of 10 Met Gala debut. Any idea who Tyla is, Jason?
No, I missed that one. Like, I missed that. How does that even work? Sand. How does that even work?
Oh my God. It was like packed onto her while she was standing. She couldn't move. All I could think of is, how is she going to pee? Because if you pee in that dress, we're going to see it.
Yeah.
And like, that's not what I look like when my children bury me in the sand and I, you know, resurrect myself. That she looked incredible. Also, it was just creative and cool and also visually interesting and beautiful. I'd like to move on to our worst dressed. Honorable mention to Lea Michele. Honorable mention. She wore a teal dress with dollar store flowers pinned to one strap. And like, it would be too easy to say it looked like a bridesmaid's dress. It didn't. It looked like a flower girl dress from one of those stores at the mall that specializes in like baptism dresses for small girls, just like tulle and flower appliques. It was not good. But she is pregnant and glowing, and I will never name a pregnant woman as my worst dress, not on this Mother's Day episode. What I will do is name the best dressed woman of the century as my worst dressed. Congratulations to Zendaya! Her first look, not the black Givenchy she changed into, but the first look, the Margiela peacock-looking situation, was my worst dressed. And listen, I know everything on Zendaya looks amazing because she eats so hard, Jason.
Is that how you say it? Does that work?
She ate.
She ate hard. She eats on all the red carpets. It's, you know, it's a buffet for her, really. It's just sometimes she's so, like, looks so good in clothes. She's so beautiful. It's hard to separate the woman from the gown. But when you take this gown off the woman and just look at it, this dress looked like she picked up a few too many notions at Fabricland. Okay, it had like little grapes hanging off of it and birds and mesh tacked on to what looked like a mother of the bride dress at a fancy hotel ballroom wedding. So congratulations, Zendaya. Finally. And by the way, that dress was designed by John Galliano, who has like famously was canceled for being very anti-Semitic. So I don't mind trashing the dress, okay? We love the woman, but I can talk shit about the dress. Finally, my sexiest dressed goes to Bad Bunny, baby.
Bad Bunny, baby.
For me, no one slays harder than Bad Bunny. Did you see him?
No.
Google it right now. What? He was wearing like a weird court jester hat and a suit with exposed stitching. He was holding a bouquet of fabric flowers, which in my fantasies were for me. But in reality, I think they were for Kendall Jenner because they were seen rekindling their romance at the after party. Either way, congratulations, Bad Bunny, baby. If you can make me horny for you wearing a plush pincushion on your head, you win sexiest of the night. Honestly, best, worst, sexiest. Congratulations to everyone rich, famous, and beautiful enough to get a $75,000 ticket to this event. Because trees are grown from earth and soil in time, so too is money made from trees. So this price reflects the passage of time in a garden. What's next?
I like this Bad Bunny look. When you were saying sexy, I thought you were it was going to be like more skin or something. But he pulls this off.
He's very covered up, but I just am like in my thirsty for Bad Bunny era. Bad Bunny, baby. He can wear anything and I'm into it. Okay, I'd like to say this. It takes a lot to shock me these days. At this point, I'm like eating dry roasted peanuts, looking at Doja Cat's wet nipples like, huh. But the roast of Tom Brady left me shook. I still can't believe what I witnessed. It happened on the weekend as a live Netflix event called GROAT, the greatest roast of all time, Tom Brady. It was hosted by Kevin Hart in front of a sold out crowd. Jason thinks the title is clever. big laugh over there just for the title.
I think that was clever, yeah.
It was clever. So they did it. This was like different than how Comedy Central used to do their roasts, right? Kevin Hart hosted it. It was in front of a sold out crowd in a stadium in LA. Thousands of people watching Tom Brady get absolutely raked over the coals by comedians and his former teammates. And because it was a live event, I don't know, it really did feel like anything could happen. And we were sort of just witnessing it as it did, because it did. It was wildly uncensored. It was also 3 hours long. Okay. This was the tortured poets department of comedy roasts. Who has the time? Comedy Central used to cut their roast down to an hour, like maybe 90 minutes. Netflix is treating this roast like Oppenheimer. And so if you didn't have 3 hours to watch it all yourself, I'm going to condense the whole thing down to a phony friendly recap.
Phony friendly recap.
So for the football superfans, Jason, I'm talking to you.
Yeah.
There was a lot of like inside baseball or like inside football. You know what I mean? Like a lot of sports references. Did you find yourself being like, what is this joke about? I don't know who Tom Brady's coach was in 1999.
95% of the time. Yeah.
Right. A lot of like Deflategate, Bill Belichick jokes that could have flown over your head. But if you're an elder millennial who responds well to the lineup at the Lovers and Friends Festival, then let me tell you the things you probably want to know about. My personal favorite comedian of the night was Nikki Glaser, who slayed in a sea of male comedians. Like truly, truly, she stood out. Did she not?
Yeah, so good. So funny. I wasn't too familiar with her before, and I'm just like, breakout.
I know. Breakout, you know night. What's sad about this? She was on MTV around the same time that Dan and I were there, so we would cross paths over at MTV. Oh. But I recently saw her make a guest appearance on Selling Sunset, as I'm sure you recall.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah. I'm putting like two and two together now. Oh, fun, yeah.
I was like, Nikki Glaser's publicist is on a tear because I loved her on Selling Sunset, loved her at this roast. She crushed every joke landed. She did not hold back, especially when it came to Tom's love life. So she touched on Tom's divorce from Giselle Bundchen. Let's start with this.
You have 7 rings. Well, 8 now that Giselle gave hers back, but...
And that was like the softest joke, okay? She then made fun of his ex-wife allegedly cheating on him by sleeping with her jujitsu instructor. You followed this story, didn't you, phonies? Listen to this.
The only thing dumber than you saying yes to this roast was when you said, hey, babe, you should try jujitsu. I think that was...
I mean, the entire time I kept thinking, why did he agree to this? How much money did they pay him? And she called it out right there. Like, why would you ever do this? But probably the biggest sting was her take on how Tom famously dumped his girlfriend, Bridget Moynihan, while she was pregnant with their child in 2008. Listen to this.
You really are, I mean, you're the best to ever play for too long. I mean, you retired, then you came back, and then you retired again. I mean, I get it. It's hard to walk away from something that's not your pregnant girlfriend. It's tough. Hey, to be fair, he didn't know she was pregnant. He just thought she was getting fat.
I'm still shocked, and I've seen this joke several times. I mean... Tom Brady looked so uncomfortable. Like the football jokes, which we'll get to, he was laughing along, whatever. But the Giselle shit, the Bridget Moynihan stuff, he was clearly uncomfortable, or at least acting uncomfortable, so that the call he's going to get from Giselle when she crawls up from under her jujitsu instructor after that aired isn't as nasty as it should be.
That's exactly what I was thinking.
Oh,
because he had to have known that that stuff would come up, obviously, right?
Right, but to sign up for a roast where you know people are going to not just drag you and your career, but your family, there's kids involved, there's another party involved. Like, oh, I felt for him. I felt for that hot white billionaire. Nikki got a standing ovation, which was very well deserved. She was the best part of the 3-hour show. Speaking of Tom's love life, still never confirmed or denied having a romance with Kim Kardashian. Remember when that was the rumor?
Yeah.
That was like everybody was trying to ship those two.
Yeah.
So I guess that was the reason why she was there. But she can be funny. She like is great at making fun of herself. She delivered that SNL monologue better than anybody expected. So I thought it was fun that she was invited and that she showed up. Others did not. As soon as Kim Kardashian walked on stage and up to the microphone, she was booed by what sounds like 99% of the Kia Forum. Listen to this.
Well, thank you. I know a lot of people make fun of your height. All right.
At first, you thought they were cheering. Thank you. I mean, she tried to just like plow through it. She could not. It was so overwhelming. Kevin Hart is going like, whoa, 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 whoa in the background there. By the way, like, ironically, she's about to make fun of him and he's out there trying to protect her. I just felt like, are we really still booing the Kardashians? Like, these football fans at this roast clearly don't know that we've moved past that, okay? This woman is a billionaire. You can boo her all you want, but she's still going home to her, like, $30 million beige manch, okay? What she did do was win the crowd back over. I think because a lot of her jokes were like her making fun of herself and her own family, her stepfather and her birth father, Robert Kardashian, were also fair game. Listen to this.
Honestly, it's hard for me to watch people roast you, but I think enough of my family members have helped defend former football players.
Tom Brady likes that one. He's clapping for that one. That's that one hit. That was good. I mean, I don't know. I think they wrote all those jokes for her. She was game enough to agree to do them. I still don't. I like want to ask Chris, like, why this? Why did we agree to put her out there at this? I guess they didn't expect her to get booed in the way she did, but I just don't see the advantage of like her walking on stage at the Tom Brady roast, you know, unless we're getting paid millions of dollars, why do that?
Well, do you, I could be missing something really obvious, but why was Will Ferrell there?
I don't know.
Also, too, like, I just thought it's such a random booking.
I think a lot of these guys are just Tom Brady stans. Like, he is the biggest celebrity for, like, straight white men probably living today. I think a lot, like, Ben Affleck also delivered jokes at the roast. Like, he's just, you know, a Boston guy who's, like, excited to be with the Patriots quarterback. Like, I think part of it is just people who are fans wanting to be involved in anything Tom Brady adjacent.
That makes sense.
And speaking of Tom Brady, he sat through what I can only imagine were like excruciating 3 hours of like jokes and burns. And as the show went on, I was secretly waiting for someone to bring up his new look. Because it's been widely discussed on the internet. He looks very smooth. He looks very taut. He looks very lifted. Finally, his former teammate Julian Edelman did. Listen to this.
Who's laughing now, Tom? Not you, because your face can't move and you don't have a sense of humor.
I'm sorry. There was part of me like preferred the football players delivering jokes and the Kim Kardashians delivering jokes over the professional comedians. Like, he made me laugh so hard, this little Julian Edelman character. God. And also, I agree, the face doesn't move, but I do disagree that he doesn't have a sense of humor. Tom took it like a man, okay? But he was also able to throw it back when he got on stage and had his chance to kind of clap back. He took shots at everybody there. He also took shots at Travis Kelce and the Kansas City Chiefs. And since this is a very pro Travis podcast, I'd be remiss not to play those jokes. Here you go.
Kansas City, you say your stadium is the loudest. It helps when all your fans are 14-year-old girls. And in honor of Tay-Tay, let's take a look at the Chiefs' eras. Terrible for 50 years, good for 5. Shake it off.
I love it. I love it. Face doesn't move, but it can sure deliver a joke. I thought he was great. Finally, Tom Brady himself had what a lot of people are saying was the joke of the night. If Kim Kardashian didn't have it bad enough with the booze, she was hit with this.
Kim was terrified to be here tonight. Not because of this, but because her kids are home with their dad.
Oh.
It was just all so shocking to me, Jason. I don't know why. I thought the Comedy Central roasts were initially sort of canceled or like stopped because we were in this new era of like the Garden of Time. You know what I mean? No right. Bullying, positivity. And we're just back to straight up dragging, trolling, bullying people for their divorces, cheating scandals, mentally ill ex-husbands. Like, Every line was crossed. Nothing was edited out. And it was wild to watch. Honestly. I did think he handled it really well. And even though I don't know why he did it, and I hope they paid him literally tens of millions of dollars to sit there, I guess for me, suddenly I'm reinvested in Tom Brady, which was probably the point. You know what I mean? He is, I guess, starting his broadcasting career as like a football analyst. He has a multi-million dollar, multi-year deal coming up. So this is his foray back into the world after retiring. And like, I'm reinvigorated by it. I'm ready to see more Tom Brady.
You know what they say?
What?
If people make fun of you, it usually means that they like you.
Oh, Jason, you're
like,
right.
You know when like the boy picks on the girl in the schoolyard because he has a crush on her? Like that's the, what's the quote I'm thinking of?
That's true. All of this is out of love. And truly, yeah. When you look at the Will Ferrells and the Ben Afflecks, like they're, it's out of love and lust. Like they are all deeply horny for this man and have been for decades.
Yeah.
And so sure, it is absolutely a celebration. I will say, Jason, you could not pay me enough to do this. If you offered me a Lovers and Friends festival in my backyard tomorrow, I would not get roasted. If one person made one of those jokes about me, I would never recover. You know who else wouldn't? Tiffany Haddish. And that brings me to what's next.
What's next?
So obviously roasting people is okay when you're getting paid millions of dollars to do it for our entertainment on a televised comedy special. It is not okay to roast people you don't know online with disgusting and hurtful comments while you hide behind your phone. And you could argue that a roast like this, okay, the groat, what was it called? The groat?
Groat, yeah.
The groat really does, like, you know, if Kim Kardashian's corset is influencing people to like starve themselves to have a waist that small, then you could argue that the groat is influencing people to be cruel and mean and hurtful on the internet. Like, I think there is a correlation between watching something like that and then internet bullying, but I digress. Tiffany Haddish does not want to hear from you trolls. She is not about being bullied on the internet. She recently sat down for an interview with the LA Times to talk about her new book, which is a collection of essays called I Curse You With Joy. And the reporter asked her about online trolls and how she handles the negativity. That's a totally innocuous question. Most celebrities would say, yeah, you know, I just like, I don't read the comments or I brush it off. Not Tiffany. She doesn't ignore it. She doesn't brush it off. She doesn't lay down and take it either. She hits them right back by creating fake Instagram accounts, posting as her alter ego, Sarah, who then DMs these anonymous trolls about, like, you know, telemarketer stuff in order to get their names, locations, and places of work. From there, she'll go online and use these nuggets of information to investigate her trolls further by pulling their credit reports and or police records, something I was not aware that you could apparently buy online for $1.99 each to get their phone numbers. And then she will call them at home personally to tell them off. Rob, I hope you added some like Mission Impossible music behind that, because that is, I mean, I just want to start by saying, Tiffany, I am so sorry. I'm here may not have said I don't like your singing voice in the Lego Movie 2 last week on this podcast. Rob, you don't have to roll it. Rob, please, Rob, don't roll it. There was a Tiffany Haddish song on the Lego soundtrack, which also plays on repeat in my house, that is so poorly sung. It's hard for me to listen. Okay, thank you so much for replaying that. So, Tiff, please don't look at my banking statements online or leak my phone number. I am on your side and I apologize. I just think it's like pretty amazing that she goes to this length to call somebody out, especially at this point in your career, because it is well known that like internet trolls usually write to celebrities because they don't think they'll ever see it. They don't think of them as human beings and they just sort of like spew hate and move on with their day and don't think it'll ever affect that person. I have experienced this, Jason. I don't think I've ever talked about this, but when MTV first launched, okay, I had never been on like a national television show like that. I didn't think anyone was watching. The internet was relatively new. Like within the first week of being on the air, someone wrote a blog post or like a, like a Tumblr, like it was early days.
MySpace even?
Could have been a MySpace post.
Okay.
And I remember the headline was, really MTV, you couldn't find anyone funnier than Jessi Cruikshank, ? And this person had written about how I was like terrible and very unfunny. And in looking back, I probably was. Like, I didn't know what I was doing. I had been on television for a week. Like, I hear it's a fair thing to write. But I felt like she was writing to me. Like, I couldn't believe that this person was even spelling my last name on the internet. Like, I was so shocked by it that I immediately just wrote her back and was like, hi, it's me. I'm so sorry you feel that way. I'm like new. I'm learning. And of course, she wrote back right away like, oh my God, I'm so sorry. Never thought you would see this. I'll take it down immediately. And she did. So like, there is something satisfying about reaching out to the haters. And Tiffany Haddish does say that most of the people she talks to are like, sorry, didn't think you would see this. Like, my bad. I also heard, I don't know if I should say this, Jason. You're my, you know, Jason, my producer. So you can cut this if you think it's inappropriate.
Okay.
But I did hear a rumor about George Strombolopoulos, who I know and love. I suppose I could reach out and have him confirm or deny. But I heard a rumor that I thought was amazing, that when a dude would go on his Instagram page and like trash him, troll him, talk shit, he would occasionally click on that person's profile and see if they had a girlfriend. And if they did, he would go to their girlfriend's profile and start commenting on their girlfriend's pictures, like fire emojis, looking good, love it, and just troll them back in the most indirect but like cutting way possible.
With a blue check mark.
Yes! Suddenly George Strombo is commenting on my girlfriend's post. Like, the ultimate revenge.
I love that.
Me too.
It's like just one extra little step.
I know.
But it's like a big statement.
I love it so much. Not sure if it's true. We'll have to confirm with George. But like, I hope it is, because it makes me love him even more. I think at the end of the day, like, please don't waste your time being rude to people in their comments or, you know, on a podcast, Jessi. I just think, why waste your time doing that now that you know that you could be using your time reading through your friends' credit reports online for only $1.99? Literally going to, like, look up police records for Evan's ex-girlfriends, okay? That's on my to-do list. What's next?
What's next?
All right, in honor of Mother's Day, I thought I should finally return a phone call from my mother. Let's phone a friend.
Girl, let's phone a friend.
I am phoning my mom, Joyce. She was a television host and producer on the CBC for my whole childhood, so she really is the only reason I thought working in television was a viable job. She's also the kindest, most generous, most beautiful person I know. Also the most ripped, okay? She still teaches fitness classes multiple times a week and somehow makes time to check in on me and my kids every single day, sometimes multiple times a day. She's currently on vacation in Greece and rarely takes her cell phone with her anywhere because she is from another time. So let's see if she picks up.
Hello.
Hi, Mom.
Hi, Jessi.
Hi.
I'm talking to you from so far away.
I know. You are vacationing in Greece.
I am in Athens right now. And I perfectly. It's amazing.
I know, the power of technology, Mommy. As you recall, I went to Greece with my best friend at 18 years old, and we made decisions that you, as my mother, would not be proud of. Did you accept drinks from strangers you met in an EOS nightclub, or did you pay for the drinks yourself?
No, I would never. In fact, I don't think I've had any drinks in an EOS nightclub. But I do remember a story about you, which I found out, of course, much later. I find out everything about you from your podcast or Instagram.
It's true.
But
it's true.
That you slept in your car.
Yes,
you guys didn't
even
have a hotel. Thank God I didn't know about that.
Yes, because when me and my friend in college, we vacationed in Greece together, we didn't have any money. Our budget was like $7 a day. And so one day we like splurged on a rental car, and then we didn't want to pay for a hostel that night. So we just slept in the car, and it got so cold at night that Kate would drive while I would sleep for an hour. And then I would drive around the island while she would sleep for an hour. And that was the really safe way that we traveled together at 18 years old.
So let me ask you this, Jessi. How would you feel if your daughter did that? Think about it. Just think about it. Like, thank
I would be like, where did I go wrong? Why? What is wrong with you, Romy? Why didn't you ask me for a, like a little extra cash to get a hostel?
Right.
Okay, so you're not sleeping in cars in Athens.
No, no. Although I have slept in cars, I have to say, in Africa. So, you know, I sort of have been there many, many, many moons ago.
Well, that's where I get it from, obviously. Mom, I called you to wish you, first and foremost, a very happy Mother's Day.
Thank you very much, sweetheart. And a very happy Mother's Day to you, too.
Isn't it crazy? I don't think I've ever asked you this. Isn't it crazy that your child is also a mom?
Yes. Yeah, it's very hard to believe, honestly. However, my child has three of the best children living on this earth. So while it seems strange to look at you as a mom and to respond to you and to react to you as a mom, and you know, that's sometimes challenging, right? We have different ideas about parenting sometimes, but it's the best thing you ever did, love.
This is very interesting that you bring this up, because I think you continue to be the best mom, best grandma, but like most loving and supportive mom in the world. You taught me everything I know about being a mom, but we do have we clash sometimes over my parenting styles. Like, how do you think our mothering styles are different?
Well, different. I mean, I guess there are different ways of approaching certain things. Well, let me give you an example. Maybe that might help. You know, when we being my generation, would toilet train children, we did it in a very different way. We didn't let them run around, you know, half naked for a whole weekend.
Right.
You know, plying them with water and candy if they happen to make it anywhere near the potty.
Yes, this is our current strategy with Romy, by the way. Go on.
Well, I know. So these are different strategies that we just didn't do those kinds of things. However, having said that, I think you're an amazing mother, a wonderful, amazing, loving, fun, spectacular mother. So I don't have a lot of concerns and worries, even though I know that some of my parenting values were a little bit different.
Okay. Well, this is a very apropos conversation, because Romy literally just shit herself whilst dropping her brothers off at school this morning. So it's really, we're struggling, Mom.
Oh, poor little thing.
I have been meaning to ask you this, like, just, I probably just need a piece of advice from you, Mom. I am the busiest I have ever been in my career right now. Like, I'm, you know, when I'm not thinking about my stand-up special, which we're editing right now, or my clothing line, or this podcast, I am feeling guilty for not being there for my kids. You were a working mom my entire childhood, when not every mom was. Did you feel that way? Like, did you feel like you were missing out on my childhood at all times?
Not at all times, but I certainly felt guilty. Yes. I mean, guilt is it's kind of goes with the territory, you know. But, you know, I think having said all that, if you ask me, do I have any regrets about my parenting? I would say that I wished I had spent a little bit more time with you guys growing up. I miss, you know, when and I think that's why grandchildren are so important, right? I can go back now and kind of, you know, spend a little bit more time watching them grow and appreciating it, because when you're so busy, you don't really, you know, you don't pay attention as much
That makes me sad to hear that, Mom. I don't want you to have any regrets about the way you raised me because, no, and now I'm crying, because I feel like the reason that I work so hard, the reason that I have had the success that I've had is because I was raised by a mom who was doing just that. I look to you, I still look to you as a shining example of what a working mom can be. And so I don't want you to feel that way because I, you know, I remember you as being present and being there. And when you were inspiring me to do exactly what you were doing.
Thank you. Thank you for saying that, sweetheart. But you asked me, you know, did I ever feel guilty? You do feel guilty. You cannot not feel guilty, you know, and you want to be with your kids as much as you possibly can. And as I say, when I look at Romy or look at Dre and Rio growing up and I see how, you know, the progress they make and how wonderful it is to watch them, you know, learn how to read or learn how to think. I don't remember those times. Now, maybe that's just, and I don't know, maybe that happens to everybody. Or maybe it's, you know, because you're a working mom, you're so busy, you're just not paying enough attention. I wish I could go backwards, you know, and really appreciate. So when did Jessi start to read and how, you know, how did that happen? How did it?
Very young. Gifted, I would
just
say.
Just you were reading when you were on the potty. You know?
Absolutely. I mean, one and a half, just novels. Mm-hmm. Go with
well,
that,
you
Mom.
You raised yourself, sweetheart. I mean, really, you were a
Yes, I am a real second child. I mean, my sister is like good at everything, type A, significantly more conservative than I am. I am just like your wild child. You watch me on MTV. You listen to this podcast. You've seen me on tour. Do you ever feel embarrassed?
I'm always very proud of you, doll. I listen to every podcast and I look at every Instagram and I'm very proud of you. I must say, occasionally I do feel a little embarrassed some of the topics that you choose. That's the absolute truth. I'm extremely proud of you, and you are your person, and you are who you are, and you do everything you do so beautifully. So, hey, I can only say how proud I am, love.
Okay, good. I'm glad because at my stand-up show in Vancouver, you brought phonies. My mom brought like seven couples in their 70s. Like all of her friends bought out a row at my show. And I'm up there swearing and like thirsting after male audience members. Bras are being thrown at me. And I was like, I hope my mom hasn't left. Like she's brought all her friends here. I hope she's okay with it.
All my friends loved it. So there you go. We're not such total funny daddies.
Okay. Well, I'm so glad to hear that and relieved. Okay. Now, Mom, you listen to Phone a Friend, right?
I do, religiously.
You're a phony.
I'm a phony.
Yeah. So, you know, we discuss important things on this show, like Travis Swelce's future and Kim Kardashian's cardigan. So I thought I would take a moment to get your take on a few hot topics. Okay. I'm going to give you a few recent celebrity headlines. You have to give me your hot take in a rapid fire game I'm calling Hot Mom Take.
Hot Mom Take.
Gosh.
Are you ready?
Oh, I'm getting nervous already.
Okay. Cue tension music. I'm going to start easy for you, Mom. 72-year-old Golden Bachelor Gary Turner announced divorce 3 months after getting married in a televised wedding. Hot Mom Take.
True.
No, wait, this is not a true or false.
Oh, what did you want me to say?
Do you know what a take is, Mom?
Yeah.
It's like your thoughts, your opinion, your like first thing that comes to mind.
Oh, okay. Do it again. Sorry. I thought you were gonna say I thought it was true or false. Sometimes you do true or false.
72-year-old Golden Bachelor Gary Turner announces divorce 3 months after getting married in a televised wedding. Hot Mom Take.
I think it was all put on to begin with. I believed it. I thought it was just all make believe, and it wasn't surprising to me at all that they decided to separate.
Mom, I watched the wedding with you. And to clarify, I forced you to sit down and watch the wedding the first time you had ever seen anything from any Bachelor franchise. And you were engrossed, were you not?
Yeah, I just couldn't believe it. You know, all the pomp and ceremony that they put into that wedding and the, you know, the cuts back and forth with the other women.
And yes.
I was just amazed by the whole thing. I'd never seen anything like that. But to be honest, I didn't believe that was for real. Did you?
Wow. Of course, Mom. I'm 100% invested. This is why I spend like 72 hours every quarter watching this show.
Oh.
Okay, next. Kim Kardashian allows her 10-year-old daughter, Northwest, to make her onstage debut in The Lion King live at the Hollywood Bowl. Hot. Mom, take.
Nah, I don't agree. I think that's putting... She's too young. And if you did that with your children, I would not be happy, Kim. You know?
You wouldn't fly out to see Rio and Dre starring in The Lion King live at the Hollywood Bowl?
Yes, no, I would. If it was Rio and Dre, you know? But, like, I don't know. I think children have to be children for much longer than we're allowing them to be children.
That's true. And can you just confirm for the phony something I discussed last week, which is I was a Lion King stan as a child. Do you know what a stan is?
No.
Oh, it's like a super fan.
Oh, yeah. Oh, for sure. Yes. You were a Lion King super fan. Yes. Stan
yes,
is a
absolutely.
Super fan. I've just learned something.
Stan. Yeah, stan. The etymology is based on an Eminem song. Anyways, let's move on.
Okay.
Kendall Jenner cozies up to ex Bad Bunny during the Met Gala after party. Hot Mom take.
I don't know. I don't even know who Bad Bunny is. I know who Kendall Jenner is. I don't know who Bad Bunny is. And, you know, I mean, so much of this is all, it's all for the photographers and, you know,
yes.
Yeah.
If it makes you feel any better, I just discovered who Bad Bunny is recently and I am fully invested.
Who is it? Isn't it he or she? I have no idea. Bad Bunny.
Well, Mom, I believe his pronouns are he, his, but he is rather gender fluid. I suggest you look into Bad Bunny. Okay, next. Gypsy Rose Blanchard. Do you know who this is?
No, not a clue.
Okay. You know what? On second thought, this is a Mother's Day episode. Let's move on. Brooke Shields reveals her college-age daughters sleep in bed with her when their dad is out of town. Hot Mom take.
Nah, I don't agree with that. I mean, why?
Mom, come on. When I come to Vancouver and stay with you, you always want me to sleep in your bed.
Well, that's a different story. I know. What are they broadcasting that they're sleeping in bed together? I mean, like, what's the point of that?
I think it's nice. I want to cuddle my children when they're college age. Is that weird?
Yeah, cuddling your children is one thing, but sleeping in the same bed with them is another. I mean, you know, you don't need to do that. I'm not sure. Do you think Brooke Shields doesn't own another bed?
Brooke Shields owns her own furniture line. She better have 12 beds.
Well, exactly. So that's my question is...
Okay, last but not least, Taylor Swift's bestie, Sabrina Carpenter, will be the SNL musical guest the same night Taylor Swift's ex, Jake Gyllenhaal, is the host. Hot Mom take.
Yeah, he's her ex, so what's wrong with that?
I'm blown away that you followed that. Excellent take, Mom.
Oh, good. Thank you. Is that how you would have responded to?
Absolutely.
Okay, there you go.
I mean,
you can't sort of, you know, carry around grudges forever and not have anything to do with these people. I mean, she's moved on.
She has moved on.
She's with Travis Kelce, whatever his name is.
Ding, ding, ding. Yes, she is. Let's just hope that Jake gives the scarf back to Sabrina to pass along to Tay-Tay. You know what I mean?
Sure, absolutely. That's very important. I would be very disappointed.
Yeah.
Yes.
No,
yeah.
You right now.
You know, Mom, I should ask you some questions. My goodness.
Go ahead.
Wait, is this still part of the rapid fire or should I end the game now?
Oh, please end the game.
Okay.
Please take me out of my misery, please.
This has been Hot Mom Take.
Hot Mom Take.
Okay, go ahead. Ask me anything, Mom.
About some of my, you know, my favorite celebrities.
Oh.
Yeah. I mean, do you know, for example, you ever heard of a guy by the name of Bryan Adams?
Mom, I went to the Bryan Adams show with my sister, your other daughter, in Seattle.
And you didn't take me. And I'm so resentful of that.
Weren't you watching the kids? So didn't we leave you with our five children? Yeah, we did. Yeah.
What's his most famous song?
Bryan Adams? Is this really the quiz that you're giving me?
I'm giving you a quiz.
Bryan Adams' most favorite song is Summer of 69.
There you go. Ding, ding, ding.
Mom, we can schedule another time and you can just give me a full Michael Bublé quiz at that time. You know what? This actually brings up a good question before I let you go. I, as you know, do another mom-related segment on this podcast, which is probably one of the aforementioned segments that you feel embarrassed by. It's called Calling All Thirsty Moms. I don't think I've ever asked you this, Mom, but who are you thirsty for?
Oh, my goodness. That's a hard question. Especially with my partner in the room.
Just tell him to step outside. Step outside, sir.
Step outside. Who? Oh, my goodness. That's a hard one. I always had a real thing for Tim McGraw.
Tim McGraw.
This guy called Elvis Presley, you know?
Mom, no. No, let's go with Tim McGraw. Do not age yourself that hard.
Okay, okay.
Tim McGraw, so you like a small man with a heavy tan?
Oh, is he small?
I believe he's quite petite.
Oh, no, I didn't think so.
Well, so are you, so that could really work.
That's true, actually. Yeah. Anyway, well, I need to think about that. You need to do it for a short time. That's the difference between you and I.
Wow. I'm going to just, Tim McGraw, this is complete. I have known you my entire life. This is absolutely new information for me. And so I'm just going to take a moment to process it. I appreciate it. I didn't know you could go country like that, Mom. Just
wait a minute. I don't know a few others.
Okay. Okay.
What about Bruce Springsteen? I mean, you know, there.
Yes, absolutely. I'm thirsty for Bruce Springsteen and I'm half his age. Okay. Anyone else?
Oh, let me think. Well, yeah, but I'll be really aging myself if I said Leonard Cohen, wouldn't I? Really aging myself.
Mom, Leonard Cohen has passed away. So RIP, you can still thirst after the dead.
Yeah.
Mom.
Oh gosh.
Too much? Too far?
Embarrassed. We got too far.
You raised me. This is your fault. I mean it when I say, Mother, I love you so much. I am who I am because of you. You are the best mom in the world. You are the best grandma on earth. I am wishing you the happiest, happiest Mother's Day. I want you to go celebrate it with that partner who's just off camera in the clubs of EOS. Will you do that for me?
I will do that for you, sweetheart. Now you're making me cry, but I have to say,
Mom,
the same thing to you, love. I just want to wish you the happiest, happiest Mother's Day. I want you to hug and kiss every one of those beautiful children for me as well. And just really, really, you know, just know how much I respect and admire you and how proud I am of you as a mother and as a career woman and as a wife and as a daughter. So that's the truth. And now I'm going to cry. So.
You're the best, Mommy. Thank you so much. I love you so much.
I love you.
And have the best trip. Call me when you're back.
I will. Bye, sweetie.
Love you, Willie.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
My mom, everybody. Hot takes from my mother. Oh, my God. Move over, Faith Hill. Joyce is coming for your man. Honestly, that was maybe the hardest I've ever laughed with a phone a friend. Like, I have tears of emotion, tears of joy. Oh, my God. I love you, Mom. And RIP Leonard Cohen. We love you, too. All respect. All respect. After the break, I am addressing a controversy that unfolded in Toronto this past week when 42 moms took out their breasts at a Blue Jays game. I'm about to unleash my rage on some Canadian folk. Next. Commercial break. And normally we play your voicemails on the show, phonies, and please keep them coming. A lot of you have been calling in about my hatred of realistic Disney animation, and I appreciate your thoughts and feedback there. My number is in the description of this episode, but occasionally I'll be the one to leave a voicemail on this show, specifically an angry voicemail. And with Mother's Day around the corner, I saw a story online that is making me do just that. So let me set the scene, Jay. A small mom-run Canadian lingerie company called Mayana Janvière, who I love. They make like beautiful... Did you like the way I pronounced that?
Yeah, I did.
Oh my God. Whenever I go seamlessly into a French accent, it reminds me of Ben Mulrooney in his broadcasting days, where he would always be like, today we're talking with Céline Dion about her new album.
Can you say Michael Bublé?
Sure, yes. Today, an exclusive with Michael Bublé. It would always be like, today, celebrities are cheering for Jean Chrétien. So the most aggressive French accent just thrown into a regular, like, broadcasting moment. Ben, I love you. So I was just trying to channel him right there. I did go to French immersion in elementary school, so it really paid off here. Mayana Janvière. They make like lingerie specifically for pregnancy, breastfeeding, and beyond. So they organized this breastfeeding flash mob at the Toronto Blue Jays baseball game last week. 42 breastfeeding moms, like 70 people in total, because they're all sitting with their babies and their toddlers, feeding them happily, comfortably throughout the game to try to bust the stigma around breastfeeding in public. It was like a group movement. You know, they had signs that said, take them out at the ball game, which I loved. And they did. So did people applaud them? Did they celebrate their bravery? Did they thank them for helping to draw attention to the shame and stigma that still exists around breastfeeding? No, Jason. And so I'd like to take 90 seconds to leave an angry voicemail.
Angry voicemail. Oh, you're so angry.
Okay, Jason, I am channeling the anger and rage that I felt when the Lovers and Friends Festival was canceled. Please put 90 seconds on the clock.
Got it.
Here we go.
3, 2, 1.
Hi, this is an angry voicemail for all of the judgy-ass people who left comments on a post celebrating this movement at the Blue Jays game. Comments like, whatever happened to decency? Are tits out really the answer? At least use a wrap or a blanket. No wonder the Jays lost. There were thousands of comments like this, and most of them, shockingly, were by women. First of all, feeding your baby should never be controversial, nor should it be sexualized. It should be normalized. And you posting dumb shit like this is a great reminder that it still is not. Maybe in Europe, not in North America. Personally, I will just say, I don't love whipping my tit out, if you want to say it like that, ma'am, in public. I would much rather be doing it in the comfort of my home on my breast friend pillow. But sometimes, as a breastfeeding mother, I have had no choice. I have other kids on the playground, or I'm on the plane, or I'm at the damn baseball game trying to live my life and give my children a great life, and I need to feed my baby. I have tried to cover up with a wrap or a blanket, ma'am, and my baby kicks it right off. I have breastfed 3 kids hiding behind bushes and in alleys and in bathrooms, and I should not have to. Breastfeeding mothers should not feel embarrassed. You should feel embarrassed for taking time out of your day to shame a woman for feeding her baby. I'm sorry. I just needed to get that off my chest, pun intended. Okay? I'm done with hiding. I'm done with, like, trying to, like, feeling embarrassed for feeding my toddler. Which, listen, I'll be the first one to joke about. I still feed my 2.5-year-old from my teat. But like, I just don't want to feel the shame anymore. And I think I speak on behalf of so many moms who feel the same way. So I applaud all of these women who went to that Blue Jays game. Mayanna Janvier, you did great. And, you know, let's try to lift some of that shame as we head into Mother's Day. Okay, all of my breastfeeding mamas. You know what? I want all women to feel empowered right in this moment. And so I think to end our show, personally, I can think of no better song than the Spice Girls' Mama. Jason, are you on board?
I thought you were going to go with something like Sean Paul or something, but...
No, festival was canceled. Fuck Sean Paul.
Right.
No Backstreet Boys, no Lil Jon, no Usher. I am boycotting for a week. Just don't worry. They'll be back next week. But right now, we're just leaning in to the girl power, the female vocal stylings of the Spice Girls. That is our show. Huge thanks to my mama. I love you. Mama, I love you. Thank you for taking time to delight and enlighten us all the way from your Grecian vacation. And happy Mother's Day to all of the moms out there. I hope you get to do whatever it is you want to do this Mother's Day, okay? Whether that is celebrate with your kids or far away from them. Jason, would you like to say anything to me in this moment?
Oh, well, yeah. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to you and happy Mother's Day to your mom, my mom.
Yes. Yeah. Can I just say happy Mother's Day to Jason's mom? Thank you. Jason, what is your mom's name?
Patricia.
Patricia? Does she go by Patty ever?
No, never Patty, Pat.
Pat.
Just Pat, yeah.
Okay. I just want to say thank you, Pat, for raising this sweet, kind, hilarious man, for turning him into a great friend and a wonderful producer. And I'm very grateful to you, Pat, in Ottawa.
I will relay that to her, since I don't think she knows what podcasts even are.
Absolutely not. Absolutely not.
Know.
No, she's like, what do you do? How do you? She still doesn't know how you make a living, honestly. Neither does my mom, clearly.
No, for real. Yeah.
Well, thanks, Pat. And thank you, as always, Jason.
Thank you. You're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you for helping to numb the pain of my lovers and friends' disappointment. Should we talk next week, mothers and friends? I thought so. Okay, have a great week. Happy Mother's Day. Bye. Hit us with the chorus. Us.
Was created by our mommy Jessi Cookson. The executive producers are Jessi Cookson and Jason Yamba. The technical producer is Rob Perra. The amazing theme song and sexy interludes are by Jay Malinowski from Bedouin Sound Clash. Phone a Friend is part of the Acast Creator Network. Credits are by us, Ray Gatica and Rio Gatica. We're her kids. That's crazy, right? Wow, you're still listening? Okay, see you next week.